Hello, I'm Malissa Fritz, host of It Takes a Co-op podcast from CHS. Today, we're taking a look at how crop protection products go from problem to solution. As a cooperative owned by farmers, our direct connection to the farm influences our product research and development process and the products we bring to market. To start, we'll talk with Steve Carlsen, Director of Crop Protection Proprietary Products with CHS. Then we'll visit the CHS Crop Science Research and Development Center in southern Minnesota and talk with Alissa Geske, who leads research efforts there. And we'll wrap up our time with a conversation with Dale Madsen, a farmer from Casselton, North Dakota. First up is Steve Carlsen. Steve, thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me today. It's great to be here.
Tell me a little bit about your job. I'm excited to learn a little bit more about product development.
I like to joke that I have one of the best jobs at CHS for what I get to do. Basically, it's being a problem solver. So what we look at here is what issues are growers facing, our customers facing, and we get to work backwards to say what product solutions can we come up with. So it's really, I like to say it's everything to do with life and death of a product, finding solutions. It's really fun for me to get to do all those different things.
So let's talk a little bit about your team. Mm-hmm. How do they decide what to test and kind of put before it gets ready to go to market? What makes that decision?
That's a fantastic question because it is it's a very interesting process, but it's really simple. And I think it's something unique we have at CHS. So with being a farmer-owned cooperative, it's pretty simple. We don't have a massive molecule discovery team or R&D for what we're doing. What we simply do is we go out to the country and we ask our agronomists that are serving those growers every day across the country, and we say, what agronomic issues are your growers having? And then we work back from those issues to say, how can we come with a solution in a product form to solve those issues? So it's really kind of a grassroots effort to say, how do we look at our portfolio and how do we work back to solve those things? Instead of us having maybe something that we've discovered and think, hey, how do we force it to market? It's really that needs-based and problem-based approach for our portfolio, which is really, I think, a great thing for us.
So what you're describing really sounds like the cooperative model in action. That's really exciting that we're seeing that information come directly from the farmer to our team and using that kind of groundswell as to identify the solutions that we need to be able to bring forward.
Yeah, it's super fun. I think it's a great example. And I'll use it where the other week I was out west visiting kind of our retail group from central Montana all the way to the PNW north of Seattle. And as you can imagine, there's a lot of diversity there. The grain farmers, large scale in Montana, all the way to the guys that are doing berries and spearmint and peppermint and all those different crops that you see out in the PNW. And we can take that and say, how can we find products that work for that berry farmer in a very unique niche market to somebody who's farming sections of land with small grains? And it's just a really fun fit to say, we're going to service every one of our growers with the solutions they need and find a product that works for them and brings those issues and solves them.
So we've got the crop science research and development area that we just opened up here in southern Minnesota. This just brings a whole new opportunity to CHS and to our farmers and our cooperative owners. Talk a little bit about what this does.
It's such a powerful tool for CHS and for our growers. And the big thing that we can have here is it's really streamlines our products for product development and what we want to look at. So my counterpart, Brian Keel, who leads our product development team, we sit down and look at all the different options. And in any given year, we can have thousands of different product candidates that come to us. And our job is to separate the wheat from the chaff. And it's really hard to have that many different things and pick the winners and losers. What the greenhouse does for CHS is we can take those thousands of different possible options and we can bring the funnel. How can we bring the best ones that are going to work consistently, provide the most agronomics, and bring them to market faster? Versus us waiting for the field season when the weather's cooperating in the spring, summer, fall to look at this, we can do multiple years of evaluation early on to make that product understood faster in how we can use it and how we can bring it to market. So it's really an accelerator for us, and it's a good validator for us when we bring products to market that are going to work, do their job, and provide ROI for our customers.
So I know it's in many areas, it's very cold right now, mm-hmm. but I like to think ahead and say, okay, the growing season is right around the corner. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about that 2025 growing season and mm-hmm. what products are coming into market that we might have touched.
Yeah, so there's a lot of different ones. So one thing that when we look at the products at CHS, it's like asking, who's your favorite child, right? There's a lot of different ones that we have. When we look at totality for the CHS portfolio, I think I ran the tally the other day and we have 270 plus products that come in a CHS box. So there's a huge diversity of what we bring to solve those problems across our whole footprint. But there's a lot of great ones that we've touched and felt. And when you think of 270 products, there's a lot of different solutions out there for everyone. And CHS has had their fingerprints on a lot of different things that are out there in the field for 25.
I've really enjoyed talking because mm-hmm. you have a passion for Love what it. You do is clear, mm-hmm. Passion for the cooperative system. But tell me if you had to pick that favorite child or pick that favorite thing, what is it you're most excited about?
That's a fantastic question because you have to look at it. So I look at it from the agronomic lens and then also what we're going to do to kind of solve solutions. I think the biggest one that's the most exciting right now for us as a company and for our growers are products that are going to revolutionize how we look at the soil and what we're going to do to provide better agronomics. So there's two in particular that I'll kind of tee up. So the first one that I'm really excited for is going to be soil applied adjuvants. So as we all know, weed resistance, weed management is a huge issue across agriculture, right? And the best weed that we can have is a weed that never emerges. Those are the ones that we can control the best. And we've got some great technologies with a product like Soil Trait to add in with those pre-emerge herbicides to make them last longer, infiltrate the soil, and help get a better control window for our weeds up front. So that soil-applied chemistry, I think, is such an exciting new area that's emerging and providing a lot of value for folks. The other one that I always look at, I think, is really important, is going to be around nutrition. So the crime that we have with nutrition and crop, you know, raising crops is that you don't always see the symptomology. And the inefficiency that we have in how we do crop nutrition is somewhat poor, right? We've got some really cool technologies here at CHS that drive better efficiency, particularly around our Levasol chelate brands, that get more efficiency out of what we're applying, making sure more of it's plant available. We got a great product that we've launched this year, Trivar EZ, that's something very unique. It's micronutrients, and it's the only ortho chelated, so most available plant nutrient that we can apply. I'm really excited for that because I think it's going to drive more activity in the soil and help us start to kind of unlock the potential that's in those fields that we're not accessing today. So those are the two things. And I would say the theme for products for this year is going to be what we're doing in the soil.
Awesome. Thank you, Steve, for the time to kind of talk big picture about it. I'm excited to go take a look at what we're doing down in our research facility.
You'll enjoy it. It's a great facility and what we can all do there. It's a great asset for us. And I'm really excited to see the fruits come out of there. We're already starting to do that and tee those up. As time goes on, there's going to be more and more great things that come out of that facility.
Awesome. Thanks for the time.
Yeah, thank you.
Next up, we'll visit the CHS Crop Science Research and Development Center. Alissa Geske leads research programs at the center. She'll tell us about the facility and describe our R&D approach.
This facility really was built to supplement and support our already existing R&D program. So historically, the program has been field research only. And so the benefit of bringing a greenhouse into that pipeline is to really help drive our product development, increase our efficiency, and lower our costs. So when you think about a field study, you're limited to the growing season. With this greenhouse, we have six different bays where we can control the temperature, and we can do that 365 days a year. So we get more looks at plants in that time frame, which allows us to narrow down 10 different biostimulants to 4 that we want to send to the field for validation under those conditions. So it really complements that process and helps us speed it up. So the research we do here focuses on our portfolio. So there's a wide range of different types of products. We start with seed treatments to support our STI customized business. So we look at different pathogens, different inoculants, not just soybeans, but our peas, our lentils, those crops that we focus with that market. We also look at our nutritional products. So we do some in-furrow broadcast type work, trying to mimic that on a small scale. And then also foliar fertilizer work and seeing if we have any benefits from those and really trying to figure out where products are best used within the growing cycle. Another big category is adjuvants. So here I'm sitting in front of a bunch of lamb's quarter, is a common weed we see in the field, and it responds really nicely in greenhouse work. So we'll spray it with a variety of different herbicides and then add our adjuvants to them to tease apart what adjuvants work best with what chemistries. So that's a very common thing that we work on here. And then lastly, and kind of the big talk, I guess, of where stuff is going is biostimulants. So trying to figure out how do we vet those in the greenhouse. So we challenge the plants with heat stress, with cold stress, drought stress, and trying to figure out, does this biostimulant need to be applied as a seed treatment? Does it need to be applied foliarly? And how does it best, how do we use it best to mitigate stress? So those are just some of the things we focus on. But as you guessed it, you know, whatever you're using in the field is probably what we test. Could really be anything. There's a lot of steps in to be able to create the conditions you want. Because like in research in a greenhouse, the biggest thing is you want to reduce all the variability from every other source other than the thing you're looking at or the thing you're testing. So if you have other confounding factors like you would in the field, that makes it hard to tease apart. So developing protocols that are very precise takes a lot of work and there's a lot of trial and error. But it's all fun and every day is different. One of the challenges that we've heard from farmers in the field through surveys and things is looking for something to mitigate saline stress or high salt soils. And so we're looking at different biostimulants applied as a seed treatment to help overcome that stress during germination. In this study here in particular, I'm gonna show you two different kind of ways that we're looking at this is with soybean seed. This first one in these petri plates here, we would actually have two. We have the product applied under a salt solution and then one applied under distilled water. And so you can't see, we just did this yesterday. They haven't started emerging, germinating yet, but we'll come through and we'll count the percent that have a radical coming out under both those conditions. And we'll determine what products help increase that germination under that stress and which ones don't. And then after that, we'll also start with those same products then continue looking at them, but under various conditions. Here we will take, this is gonna be our sand germination study, and we're actually gonna do this under a cold environment. So here I have just the seeds on top. They obviously would be covered after. And there's 50 seeds in here, so we'll get a count out of 50. But these will be planted and put in our growth chamber that will be at 55 degrees, kind of simulating like a really cold soil planting condition. We'll expose them to 5 days of that stress, and then we'll bump the temperature up, and then we'll measure how well they germinate, well, more so emergence, breaking through, and record that. And that will give us a good understanding of how well these biostimulant products perform under a saline stress and as well a cold germ stress. But we just planted this study, and this is the focus of this is looking at biostimulants on soybeans applied at R1. So the idea is that at R1, after application, we'll pull dippers or the water source on these pots, and we'll see how well that biostimulant helps mitigate the drought stress response. So we'll get them to like just at that point of wilting, and then we'll give that water source back and measure recovery. And so when you have an untreated plant versus something treated with a biostimulant, our hope is to be able to see better recovery from that stress, and also more pods or, you know, keeping more of those pods on the plant. So trying to see if where these biostimulants work best, is it at R1? And then we're gonna do this exact same kind of study, but in a seed treatment version. So it's looking at early stress, drought stress after seed treatment with biostimulants. So something that works really well at R1 could not work very well at seed treatment. Every day we come to work, we're thinking about the grower owner. We have the cooperative mindset in hand, and the solutions and problems that we're trying to solve here are real world problems that come to us from the field. I grew up on a farm. There's problems that my brother faces today that I am looking at in the greenhouse. So it's fun when I get to go home and discuss with a grower what solutions I'm working on developing. So we always have the grower in mind and are really motivated by that here at the CHS Crop Science Research Center.
On-farm research and testing is vital to make sure that we've got the products that work in all sorts of different conditions for our farmer owners and our cooperative owners. And so in order for us to make sure that those products truly work in real-world conditions, we have to do testing, field testing. And so let's talk today with one of the farmers that has dedicated part of his operation to helping to do field trials. And so let's talk right now with Dale Madsen, a farmer from Casselton, North Dakota. So Dale, thank you for joining us today. Will you tell me a little bit about your operation?
We're a small soybean corn farmer. I mean, it's tough to get land at the cash rent that for what the cash rent is going for now, but it's a totally a family farm. I mean, it's just relatives that I rent from plus the land that I own. So, my son is in partnership with me and I have my wife and we have another married daughter. So been all under Madsen name for 5 generations. And actually there is a 3-year-old sixth generation on the farm now. So,
oh, that's really special. That truly represents everything that I know to be of a co-op and that co-op model. So congratulations to you. What a family history.
Thank you.
We have a lot to say thanks as well to you, though, because you participate on your farm in field trials. So really important trials to help test products and whatnot. Could you tell me a little bit about why that is something that you've committed to doing?
Oh, I really like having field trials. Granted, that the only field trials that I have going on currently is through North Dakota State University. And they usually do SCN, soybean cyst nematode trials, or IDC, iron deficiency chlorosis trials is what they've conducted on my farm. A person learns a lot from having yield trials and other trials too, adjuvants and different nutrients and stuff. And I use anything that the co-op suggests that I do, so.
You're absolutely right that there is a lot of information that's garnered. And I know you get some of that information. We get some of that information from a cooperative perspective. We partner with land-grant universities all the time as well to share terrific and important information. But that definitely, it still takes a commitment from your side of it. So talk a little bit more about those benefits that you might see.
Well, I love working with, you know, for yield trials and stuff like that. I wish there was more people approaching me to even do trials on my land. I enjoy learning for what my ground will do for these different trials.
Well, first and foremost, Dale, thank you for that zest for learning. Thank you for being willing to be a part of these types of trials. Thank you for your business and being a part of the cooperative as well. Let's keep all those generations that are coming onto your farm interested in that co-op model too, because that is the future of where we head in this co-op system. Thank you so much for giving me some time today and sharing some of your insight into what it looks like to be a farmer and work with these land trials. Really, really, really appreciate it.
Well, thank you too. Co-ops are the best thing there is.
Couldn't agree more. Thanks to Steve, Alissa, and Dale for explaining and showing us the various stages of bringing new crop protection products to market. It's exciting to see how ideas triggered by growers' needs on the farm turn into product concepts that are tested and validated and become real solutions to help farmers succeed. That's the kind of collaboration we see every day in the co-op system. That will do for this episode of It Takes a Co-op. Check out our show notes for more information, and please join us again next month. Thanks for listening.